Let's bow our heads, shall we? Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you. I bless your name, Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless your holy name. Lord, we're counting on you. We're counting on you to speak to us today. We're counting on you to say something to us today that makes sense. We're counting on you, Lord God, to change our hearts. We're counting on you to change our minds about things. In fact, that's what repentance is metanoia in the Greek. It means to change your mind. Lord, we're counting on you to change our minds. And Lord, the weird thing is we're counting on you to use me. And that's the real miracle. Lord, I know that everything that's right about me is you, Jesus. Everything right about me is you. And everything wrong about me is still me. And I just pray that me is out of the way and you shine through. And we hear what you have to say to us in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. You know, thank you. That was a great prayer. If I do say so myself. You know, they gave me an award one time for this message on humility, but they had to take it away from me because I was showing it to too many people. You know, I was telling everybody in the first service, because you can tell when the Niners are playing, because first service is packed. And it's like, guys, they don't play till 3:30, you know? I mean, but, you know, the first service is a lot of tailgaters. So anyway, we're talking about eternity matters. You know why? Because eternity matters more than anything else. Eternity matters more than money. Eternity matters more than health. Eternity matters more than marriage. Eternity matters more than relationships. Eternity matters more than anything else in your life is what God is doing in you. And we're going to talk about this today because we're talking about this guy named Joseph who, let me tell you, I just finished Genesis this morning, and I've been studying the life of Joseph, which is Genesis chapter 37 and then chapters 39 through 50. It's all about Joseph and the family dynamics and Egypt and what God did and all that happened to Joseph. But we're going to touch on those things a little bit today. But this Joseph guy, man, I'll tell you, when I get to heaven, there's just some people I want to schedule for dinner, right? I want to have dinner with David. Now, I don't want to wrestle with David. There's some people in the Bible, there's some dudes in the Bible that you wouldn't want to spar with. But have dinner. I'd like to have dinner with David. I'd love to have dinner with Daniel. I'd love to have dinner with Peter and James and John and Paul and Abraham and Moses. We're going to get to meet all these people. Man, I really want to get to know Joseph because this is a good man. He was just a good, good guy. And I think he's somebody that we would all really, really like. There was a quality about him. There was a spirit about him. It was the Spirit of God, of course, but he yielded. You see, the Spirit of God can work in all of us. And he wants to work in all of us if we'll yield. If we'll rest in him, if we'll relax, right? And so Joseph was just able, in spite of all that was happening in his life. And you remember, I mean, I know I've talked about it, but let me just catch you real quick on Joseph's life. He was son number 11. That means he had 10 older brothers. 10 older brothers. Almost. He made a football team. When he arrived, they had a starting unit. So he had 10 older brothers. And let me tell you something about his older brothers. They hated him. Hated. They couldn't. The Bible says they couldn't even say a kind word to him. Now, that's dysfunction. Growing up in that environment, part of the reason they hated him, and this was no fault of Joseph's, part of the reason they hated him is because his dad favored him over the others. I mean, that wasn't fair to Joseph, but his brothers, oh, here comes dad's favorite. You know, here's the teacher's pet. I had to endure that all the time. I was always the teacher's favorite. I don't know too many of you believe in that. You know, my dad taught me. My dad was my teacher in school, one of my teachers in high school. My dad taught science in high school. And get this. You know what else my dad taught? I had to sit in his class. Sex education. My dad was a sex education teacher. And I sat in his class. And I wasn't even his favorite student in any of his classes. I was never the teacher's pet, even when my dad was the teacher. In fact, my dad used to say in science, we use my son as the barometer. If he understands what I'm talking about, then I know you all got it. Hey, it's just my dad. I know. My dad took every opportunity to tease me. My parents, they were making sure that Joni wanted to marry me. not the other way around. Everybody, I mean, all the professors at college, are you sure you want to marry him? Her parents, are you sure you want to marry him? My parents, are you sure you want to marry him? I mean, it's like, come on. But anyway, it wasn't Joseph's fault that he was the teacher's or his dad's favorite. And his brothers hated him because of it. They hated him so much they were going to kill him. And then they said, wait a minute, why kill him? Let's sell him so we can get some money. They sold him into slavery. And then, as a slave, he's working for Potiphar, and he does such a great job. And the Bible says in Genesis chapter 39 that Joseph was well-built and handsome. So he was a good-looking dude, all right? And Potiphar's wife took notice of that, and she wanted to have sex with him. And she urged him day after day after day to have sex with him. Well, that's pressure. And he kept saying, no, no, no. How can I do this? Your husband has put me in charge of his whole estate. Why would I want to do something like that and offend God? And so she finally got tired and said, all right. And so she told her husband, he tried to rape me. Gets thrown in prison. All these things happen to him. And then when he finally meets his brothers, because now somehow, well, not somehow, God how. Not somehow, God how. He becomes second. Now listen, he's a foreigner, so he's an alien. He's a convicted felon for attempted rape. Now that's three strikes against you in Egypt, 4,000 years ago in the Middle East. And he becomes second in the land. Not somehow, God how. And now, because there's this famine, his brothers, who don't recognize him now, because now he's Egyptian. He looks Egyptian. He's dressed like an Egyptian. Plus, they would never think that our brother's second in the land. We sold him into slavery to the Ishmaelites. What, and now he's in Egypt? And they come to buy grain from him, and he recognizes them, and he toys with them a bit. But he tells them, look, you intended to harm me. This is after he reveals himself to him. I'm your brother. I'm Joseph, who you sold into slavery. He says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. Now, I want you to see the word intended. That's a very important word. We're going to look at that for a few minutes. Because God has an eternal plan for our problems. How many of you, by a show of hands, mostly I want to just see if you're awake, how many of you have problems? All right, those of you that didn't raise your hand, how many of you had problems? All right, how many, don't raise your hand on this, how many are sitting next to a problem? No, don't raise your hand. Joni, put your hand down. We're not even sitting by each other. We've all had problems. Do you know God has a plan for those problems? I don't care what they were. I don't care what they are. They could be the worst thing in the world. God has a plan for it. And it's a good plan. It's for the good of others that you have problems. Now, not that they're all happy that you have problems, though there are some people that are. But when God is doing something through a problem or with a problem in your life, it's because he wants you to be a witness to them. So if you have come through a problem, and I could ask this question, you could all raise your hand. How many of you have come through a problem? You're on the other side of the problem. Whether it's an addiction, whether it's a heartbreak, whether it's a betrayal, whether you've learned to forgive somebody that offended you, somehow you've come through a problem, and in coming through a problem, guess what you have now? A voice. You have something to say to someone. God can take your test and turn it into a testimony. God wants to take your messes and turn them into his message. And then we do that by allowing him. And this is what Joseph says to his brothers, which is very similar to what he said in Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. In Genesis chapter 45, verse 5, after he reveals himself to his brothers, he says, no, it's me. It's Joseph. It's me. He said, do not, he's telling his brothers who sold him into slavery, do not be distressed. And do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives for the good of others. You have had problems, and you may have problems now, and you will probably in the future have problems for the good of others. So you have a testimony. So you can help other people that are going through heartache, that are going through struggles, that are suffering, that are enslaved. To save lives that God sent me ahead of you. Now that word intended that I mentioned earlier from Genesis chapter 50 verse 20, it has two meanings. You intended it for harm. God intended it for good. So intentions can go either way, good or bad. Now, negatively, the word intended means to plot against. There are people that may have plotted against you, co-workers, maybe an ex, maybe a friend who you thought was a friend, and they fabricated some things about you, or they devised something that would bring you harm or shame or embarrassment. That's one of the ways that intended is meant. And in a positive way, it means to weave, means to thread. And when Joseph was saying that God intended for good, he was saying that God used what you did to me. You intended to harm me, but God was weaving and threading it through my life to make this tapestry that you now see here, with a lot of black in it, but it's got a lot of bright colors as well. And it's for the good of others. God was weaving and threading through Joseph's life all the problems that had happened to him, in spite of it, for others. And he's doing the same for you. People, circumstances, environment, they have intentions. Some intentions are good. Some intentions are bad. God has intentions for your life. None of them are bad. They're all good. They're all good. So how, this is crucial for every human being alive. How we respond determines who we will be. You get to choose. You can't choose your problems. Now, some of them you could have made a better choice and you wouldn't have the problems, right? I mean, I got to admit, I'm my biggest problem. If I could get rid of me, my life would be a lot smoother. I create and cause some of my own difficulties. And I'm not alone there. But some problems, I didn't choose this. I didn't ask for this. And it's here anyway. So I can't determine my problems, but I can determine my response, what I allow it to do in me. That's what's important. And then what I let it bring forth from me. And so how you respond to the problems that you have is going to determine your mental health, your emotional health, even your physical health, and then the health of those around you. And I want the people around me to be healthy. I don't want to be the cause of discomfort to anyone or the cause of distress to anyone. And I love how Joseph says that to his brothers. He said, don't be distressed. Be at peace. Be at peace. And I want to live my life in such a way, and I want to respond to the problems in my life in such a way that people around me can live in peace with me in spite of the negative. Joseph, he could have chosen to be an angry person, couldn't he? And who would have blamed him? You think about it. Hated by your brothers, sold into slavery, falsely accused of rape, thrown in prison in a foreign land without ever any hope. No reasonable hope. Now, there's hope if you have God. There's hope if you have God. But there was no reasonable hope that he would ever be released. Because I'm pretty sure that if you tried to rape the captain of the guard's wife and you were a slave, you're either going to be killed or you're in there for life. He had no reasonable hope of ever getting out of prison. And we could have all understood that, oh, he's an angry man. Well, look at what happened to him in his life. Oh, well, that explains it. No wonder he's bitter. No wonder he's fuming. No wonder he wants vengeance. Do you know when Joseph met his brothers after they sold him, when he's the second in command in Egypt, which is, at that time Egypt was the most powerful nation in Africa, in the Middle East? What do you think he could have done to his brothers if he had wanted to? Arrest him, put him in jail. Potiphar, remember, I used to work for you, now you work for me. How weird was that? Do you ever think about that? Potiphar's wife having to look at Joseph and know he's second in command, and she falsely accused him of rape. And Potiphar has to answer to him now. How God can reverse things if we just wait. if we just trust, God can turn things around. Like, and he could have said to Potiphar, "Hey, Potiphar, come here. See those 10 guys over there? I want you to put them to death. This afternoon, I'd like it taken care of. Let me know when it's done." We'd all understood. But Joseph chose not to be an angry man. You know, I know he chose that because everywhere he was stationed, he was elevated. Everywhere he was stationed, he was prospered. Even as a slave, he was prospered. Even as in prison, he was prospered. God doesn't prosper angry people, resentful, bitter people. Did you hear me? God does not prosper angry, bitter people. They do not receive the favor of the Lord. You're angry and bitter over stuff? God is not going to favor that. He will not reward that childish behavior from you because he's a good dad who loves you too much to allow you to be childish and angry and frothing and foaming at the mouth at everything and bitter and unforgiving and resentful. God does not bless that. And we know that God blessed Joseph everywhere he went because he was not an angry, bitter, resentful, childish man. He grew up and he said, "Life's tough, but God's still with me." And as a result, God was able to turn everything around for him. And he can do the same. He allowed God to make good for him. Can God make good for you even though you're lonely? Even though you're struggling with your job? Even though financially you're struggling? Even though with your housing you're struggling? Can God still bless you? Can God still make good on it? Or is he done? Are the problems just too much for God? If the problems that you have are too much for your God, you've got the wrong God. Reject him and go find another one. My God can handle it all. In fact, just this morning in Matthew chapter 19, I read, Jesus said, "With man this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible." God can take a convicted felon accused of rape, a foreigner in a land, and make him vice president. God can do that. Even though he was hated, he stayed gentle. Paul said this in Ephesians chapter 4. It's a word for you. I did not give this to the first service. This just came to me just now. I know this is a word from the Lord for somebody. "Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near." Let your gentleness, because you have gentleness in you. See, if you've given your heart to Christ, one of the fruit of the Spirit is gentleness. And the Holy Spirit's in you. We're talking about that tomorrow night. The Holy Spirit's in you. If he's in you, then there's gentleness in you. Whether you're a rageaholic or not, gentleness is in you. "Let your gentleness be evident to all." Philippians chapter 4, verse 5. The Lord is near. In other words, God's watching. God's watching. Joseph stayed gentle. He could have come down on his brothers. And he didn't. When he revealed himself, he was weeping over them and hugging them. He was sold, yet he still saw his value. You've had demeaning things happen to you, but you can still see your value as a child of God. He was enslaved, yet he became a servant. He didn't act like a slave. He became a servant. That's choice. Slavery is not choice. Servanthood is choice. He was accused, yet he stayed quiet. He let God defend him. He entrusted himself to God. He was jailed, and even though he was in jail, which is the worst place you could have been, he still sought God's favor, and God gave him favor in jail. He was forgotten. He was sold. Most theologians believe that Joseph was around 17 years old when he was sold into slavery. He didn't become second in the land of Egypt until he was 30. That's 13 years. Did I get it right? Is it 13? Somebody get your phone out and do the math. I don't have my phone with me. 13 years! 13 years! Before it turned around. But he stayed faithful. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. God allows problems in your life, the worst and some that are not as bad, for the good of others. And also for the good of you. For the good of you. Romans 8:28. And we know, I know this, that in all things, there's those words, two words again, all things. You might want to, just as you're reading your scriptures, and I pray you're reading your Bible through from cover to cover every year, and if you did list last year, let me know. Let Lori know so we can give you, know how many Bibles we're going to order, because we're going to give you a Bible when you read your Bible. And then you can give it to somebody else and show them, this is what's setting me free. This is what's setting me free. Jesus said this in John chapter 8, verse 32. He said, then you'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The truth, the Word of God is truth. The Word of God, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. In John 1:1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus and the Word is truth. The more I know Jesus, the more I know the Word, the more truth that comes to my life, the more truth that comes to my life, the more I'm set free from stuff like anger, bitterness, resentment, unforgiveness. It sets me free. Get the Word. Let it set you free. We know because we're knowing the truth, that in all things, those two words, as you're reading your scriptures now, I want you to be looking for those two words. They might be coming up a lot in the future. All things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who've been called according to His purpose. See, God's always at work in His kids. He's always at work in you. Always. Even if you don't realize it. Joseph, listen, we read, I can read the story of Joseph, chapter 37 of Genesis, chapter 39 through 50. I can read that in a little bit of time. It's quite a novel. It'd be quite a movie. That would be an awesome movie. And the Bible said he was well-built and handsome, so we'd have to probably get like Bradley Cooper to be Joseph, you know? But, I don't know what happens to me sometimes. Joseph didn't know this was going to end like this. He didn't know what tomorrow was. We do. We can see the end. Joseph lived it. 13 years. When am I ever getting out of here? Now, if you're not one of his kids, that means what it means to be not one of his kids is that you've not asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart. You've not asked him to forgive you of your sin. You've not confessed him as your Lord and Savior. So you're not one of his kids. But you are one of his creation. And if you're not one of his kids, only his creation, he's at work in you too. He's at work in everybody. That's just the way God rolls. He loves always. He loves all, always. And he always wants the best for us. Even those that hate his guts. Even those people that use his name as profanity. He loves. That just amazes me about God. Because if you had unbridled power, you could do anything you wanted and didn't have to answer to anyone. If you had unbridled power and could do whatever you wanted to whoever you wanted and didn't have to answer to anyone, more than likely most of us would kill our enemies. We would destroy anyone that hated us. That's our nature. We would take it on ourselves to kill. And God doesn't. Because he loves. You know what I've learned about myself, and you know what I'm learning about human beings and this journey that we're on as Christians? The more hate that I have in my heart, the less Jesus is at work in me. God is love. God is love. If I'm hateful, judgmental, angry, bitter, resentful, and unforgiving, that is a sign that Jesus is not at work in my life. It's scary. The more forgiving I am, the more loving I am, the less hateful I am, the less judgmental I am of others, that's a sign that Jesus and the Holy Spirit is at work in my heart. What about you? That's me. That's what I've determined about me. But what about you? If you're unable to forgive, if you're unable to love, if hatred is still reigning over what that person did to you, you can't forgive them, you can't let it go, What does that say about the work of God in your life? All I want is for you to be better. All I want is for me to be better. You know what I know? I know that I like myself better than I did 20 years ago. I like myself better than I did 10 years ago. I like myself better today than I did than the version of me 5 years ago. Because I am getting better. Does that mean I'm perfect? I'm close. You know that's not true if I said it. But I am getting better. And you know what? A week from now, I want to like myself more and be better than I am today. God, even people that hate him, even people that ignore him, even people that use his name as cursing, all those people, he loves them. He just wants the best for them. He's remarkable. I want to be remarkable. I'm Mark. I want to be remarkable. Come on, that was pretty good. He uses every opportunity. God uses every opportunity to strengthen you, every opportunity to encourage you, every opportunity to spur you on to be better. That's what God's doing. So I can look at my problems and go, okay, I can see these a little differently now. Maybe I don't have to be angry. Maybe I don't have to be frustrated. Maybe I don't have to say, why me? Maybe I can say, okay, God, I don't know what you're doing. Maybe this problem is because you can see me becoming even better because of it. It changes our perspective. And when your perspective changes, you're not as angry over stuff. You're not as frustrated. You're able to just go, okay. Like I said last week, 4-2. Breathe in 4. Breathe out 2. God's in control. Psalms 46:10, be still and know that I am God. He's just not all worried about stuff. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. God's coming soon. He's with me now. Joseph could do that. Now, for those of us who love God, and I want you to know I love God. I love Jesus. I love God. I love the Holy Spirit. I love his word. And I'm called according to his purpose. That means I want to follow him. I really want his work in my life. That's what that means. And you know what that work is? It's for me to be like Jesus. That's what God wants, is for me to be like Jesus. That's why I say everything that's right about me is Jesus. Every right word that comes out of my mouth is Jesus. Every wrong word that comes out of my mouth, that's me. So if you ever hear me say something wrong or bad or whatever, you can just look at him and say, that's just Mark being Mark. He's not very remarkable. God is not just, if you love God and are called according to his purpose, which is to be like Jesus, then he's not just working in your life. He is changing you. He's changing you. He's creating the nature of Jesus. You know, it's interesting. In the book of Acts, when the church was growing, Jesus has already ascended, the Holy Spirit's working in them, and the church is growing, and God's adding to their number daily of those who are being saved, and missionary or disciples are going out from Jerusalem, and they're leading people to Christ, and churches are being sprung up and started all over. And in Antioch, there was a town. It's near Rome, Antioch. They first started calling the followers. See, before they were called Christians. See, we're called Christians now. Before we were called Christians, we were followers of the way. Jesus said, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life." They were called followers of the way or followers of Jesus. But in Antioch, what they did is they first started calling them Christians. And in the Greek, the word Christian means like Jesus, like Christ. Little Christs is another definition. And so what the people of Antioch noticed is that church over there, the followers of the way, they're so much like Jesus, they're Christians. They're like Christ. They're little Christs. Jesus wants me to be like him, a Christian, like him. Because God foreknew and predestined me to be conformed to the likeness of Jesus. Now, some say he predestined me, then that doesn't mean that means I don't have a choice. No, God knew what your choice was going to be before you made your choice. And so he's already been working in your life because he knew you would give your heart to him, and he knew that what would happen afterwards. And so it's all predestined because you chose him. He chose you first. It's amazing. And it's all so that we be conformed. That word conformed just simply means shaped, morphed. You can't see what's going on inside of me, but over the years that I've been following Jesus Christ, which is now entering year 39, there's been a morph, a transformation that's been happening over these years. I know some of you are thinking, man, you'd think you'd be better after 39 years. I know. I'm stubborn. I'm stupid. I want my own way. I'm different than you. You get it real quick and you just follow Jesus like crazy. Me, I've been kicking and screaming for years, kicking against the goats. And God's just like, he keeps working with me. And it's taken a long time, but this is God's second goal for my life, is for me to be like Jesus. That's the second goal he has for you, is for you to be like Jesus. Second goal for God. Well, what's the first goal? That you give him your sins. You confess your sins to him, and you ask him to forgive you, and you ask him to come into your heart and be the Lord of your life. Salvation is the first goal that God has. The Lord wills that all men, it's his desire, it's his will that everyone come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Every man, woman, child, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. He wants everyone to confess their sins and call on him as Lord. And once that's done, the moment that I gave my life to Jesus, the second goal, me becoming like Jesus, began right away. The Holy Spirit came into my heart, and God started shaping and morphing and molding me into his image. And the more I yield, the faster it goes. The less I yield, the slower it takes. But it's all my decision. The Holy Spirit's ready to go in me all the time. So the first goal is that we confess. The second goal is that we become conformed into the image. So once the first is done, and it's done in me, I don't need to keep asking Jesus to come into my heart. What I do now is I ask Jesus to forgive me of my sin, my unbelief. So once the first is done, the second is an adventure for eternity. Because even after I go to heaven, every time I see Jesus, I'm going to be changed. Every time I see God, I'm going to be changed. I'm going to be new and new and newer and newer and more remarkable and more remarkable. That's just how God wants to make us. I want you to bow your heads. If you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ, if you've never asked him to come into your life, if you've never confessed your sins, if you've never said, Lord, Jesus, will you be my Lord? If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. All you have to do is ask. Ask and believe. Ask and believe. Ask and believe. Jesus, come into my life. I believe that you're the Lord. I believe that you're my Lord. I want you to be my Lord. I want you to forgive me of my sins. Come in and dwell in my heart and be with me forever. That's all you have to ask. You have to ask him, though. Because he's a gentleman. Revelation chapter 3, verse 20 says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come in and I'll be with him and he with me. But you've got to open the door of your heart. Ask him. If you'd like to ask him this morning, just slip your hand up so I can pray with you. I want to know who I'm praying with this morning. Yep, good decision, good decision, good decision, great decision. Wonderful, this is it. This is all you do. Jesus, I need you. Please come into my heart. Please forgive me of my sins. I confess you as Jesus, as Lord. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe that you were risen for me. And I believe that you have a place for me. I don't want to be an orphan any longer. I no longer want to be a slave to sin. I no longer want to be a slave to fear. I want to be free in you. Just ask him. And he says, sure. Right away. And the rest of us lot, this sorry lot, us humans, God, keep using us. Keep working in us. He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It's Philippians 1:6. I know whom I have believed in, and I'm fully persuaded that he's able to keep or guard what I've entrusted to him against that day. Thank you, Father. I love you. Keep doing your good work in me, Jesus, and your good work in all of us. In your name we pray. Amen. And one more thing, Lord, I want to pray. Lord Jesus, we do ask that you would let the 49ers win today. Amen.
Hi, I'm Pastor Chad, one of the staff pastors here at the Foothills Church. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to our channel. Also, you can donate with this link down in the bottom or go to our website, thefoothillschurch.org.